So if you follow my class so far, you know that I like to give a little bit of history when I talk about a specific topic. So I'm going to do the same also in this case for refactoring. And I'm going to start by mentioning the fact that refactoring is something that programmers have always done. I gave you a trivial example just a minute ago of what refactoring is. So even more complicated refactorings are something that are commonplace for developers. Somehow refactoring is especially important in the context of object-oriented languages. And probably it's because the object-oriented features are well-suited to make designs flexible and reusable because of the fact that they help encapsulation, information hiding, and so they make it easier to modify something without changing the functionality that it provides to the outside world. However, you should keep in mind that refactoring is really not specific to object-oriented languages. You can also refactor other languages. It's just more common to see it in that context. So one of the first examples of a specific discussion of what refactorings are is Updike's PhD thesis in 1990, which discusses refactorings for Smalltalk. And some of you might be familiar with Smalltalk, which is a specific object-oriented language. And in more recent times, refactoring is becoming increasingly popular due to lightweight development methodologies, due to agile development, which is something that we just discussed in this class. For example, when we talked about extreme programming, we mentioned refactoring a few times. And the reason why it's so popular is because refactoring is one of the practices that help making changes less expensive and therefore adapt to changing requirements and to changing environment more quickly. And continuing with this historical perspective, one of the milestones in the history of refactorings is the book by Martin Fowler. This is a book entitled Improving the Design of Existing Code, and it contains a catalog of refactorings, a list of bad smells in code, and we're going to see what that means exactly. Nothing to do with other kinds of bad smells. It talks about guidelines on when to apply refactoring. And finally, which is very useful, it provides example of code before and after applying a refactoring. And we're going to use more or less the same style when discussing refactoring in the rest of this lesson. More specifically, what we're discussing next are some examples of refactorings, and also some examples of code bad smells.